Hey, it's me, Robbie Burns. This is the last of three podcast episodes I'm releasing that are aligned to the three sessions I'm presenting at the New Jersey Music Educators Association Conference this week. My last two podcast episodes, Digital Organization Tips for Music Teachers and Practical Projects for Your Elective Course, align to those two sessions. And this one is all about teaching intonation with Tonal Energy. I'm going to talk up front a little bit about some recent changes to my technological and intonation teaching workflow, but then what will follow is a reissue of episode 49, Teaching Intonation with Tonal Energy, featuring my colleague, Ben Denne. So before the episode gets started, I wanted to mention actually a pretty significant purchase and addition to our front of room setup that happened just within the past couple of months. We did at my school actually buy a Yamaha Harmony Director for the band and orchestra rehearsal space. And this is after years and years and years of not only teaching intonation using drones and justly in tune intervals, but this is also after years and years of trying to use other more cost-effective and space-efficient technologies to simulate some of the features that the Yamaha Harmony Director is known for. In this podcast episode, I'm going to go into great detail about using the Tonal Energy Tuner app in combination with a Bluetooth keyboard in order to like play chords and like snap the intonation in the key center into other keys, kind of like on the fly. Well, the Yamaha Harmony Director is a synthesizer made by Yamaha, which is designed for this exact purpose. We have it set up in the front of our room. In other episodes of the show, I've detailed my front of room setup and what is entailed in that. It's kind of like a mixer, a music stand, a podium, and then into the mixer goes a Mac, an iPhone, and a headset microphone that some of the teachers in the building wear when they teach. Well, now we have another channel dedicated to the Yamaha Harmony Director, which is able to pump loud metronomes and drones through the loudspeakers. Now, while Tonal Energy and a Bluetooth keyboard can very, very effectively simulate some of these features, I have to say having a dedicated piece of hardware for the purpose of playing metronomes and drones is absolutely a game-changing experience. The Yamaha Harmony Director has the ability to really on the fly, like change between timbres and to change between settings, equal temper, just intonation. Of course, playing a chord in the just intonation mode will immediately snap all of the intervals into the key area of whatever chord you play. So like if I play an A major chord, it'll lower the thirds, you know, all the C sharps and raise all the fifths, the E's. And this makes it really effective for sort of like performing the intonation to the students. And I have like some keyboard skill. So like what's cool is now I'm able to play much more technically detailed melodies alongside of them while modeling for them the intonation I want them to have. And this has been kind of a cool thing to be able to use in class. And, you know, now that I'm sort of practicing it every day in rehearsal and learning the instrument and the tool, I'm becoming much more effective and fast-paced in my ability to provide that resource for them through the speakers without as much downtime with me, like, fiddling with settings and things. I'm really impressed by the metronome. All of these features I'm mentioning, by the way, have dedicated buttons on the screen, so there's, like, no digging around in menus in order to make this stuff happen. You just sort of, like, learn where the buttons are, and then in the same way that you could, you know, play the notes of a scale, you can turn on a metronome to exactly the tempo you want just by, for example, tapping the tap tempo button four times at whatever speed you want. So I would go tap, 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 and then right where the fifth tap would be, a click starts coming through the loudspeakers. Click, 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 click. Just like a good old Dr. Beat, I have a mixer, which allows me to turn up and down the volume of the quarter note, eighth note, 16th note, or eighth note triplet. And I'm using this a ton. I actually am like kind of stoked about the metronome. I've been using it more than I thought I would. And I have almost no desire to use the kinds of tools I was using through my iPhone and my Mac operating systems. Because this keyboard, you know, it takes away all of the friction. It's just all the buttons are just there, ready to be tapped. It's sort of offset to the left. Ben Denne, who's actually featured on this episode that's about to replay in a few minutes, he actually built this really great wood table for the keyboard that has a mounting system that attaches to the top of our mixer. So it sort of hovers over top the mixer with all the sliders still easily reachable by the left hand. Then there's a percussion table with a laptop and some other pencils and pens and stuff on it, slightly to the right of that. And then directly in front of me is my music stand where I keep my iPad with all of my scores and my seating charts on it. And then I have a little bit of a walkway to kind of get out of there to my right. And it's a nice little command station. It makes me feel very powerful and very in control. And it's just been an absolute delight to get to know the features better of this keyboard, which for so long has been the model for like all of the tuning technologies and apps and workflows that I detail in the following episode. So it's been really great. The Yamaha Harmony Director is much more affordable now than it used to be. There's like a new version of it that's several hundred dollars cheaper. If you have the means to acquire one of these and you teach in a performing ensemble where it would be useful, I can't recommend it enough. It's been an amazing tool. All right, well, now that I've talked about that, I'm going to go reissue that episode, Teaching Intonation with Tonal Energy, featuring my colleague Ben Denne, where not only will I talk more in detail about the why of like using tuning drones and like some of the how of using tuning drones, but also I'll get specifically into some of the teaching practices that we have developed around focusing on that skill set. Hope you enjoy it. Okay, wait, actually, I was just about to publish this episode, and then I found some news, some breaking news. The Tonal Energy Tuner app is now available on Mac and Windows. This is not a drill. Users of the Tonal Energy app can go download it right now. It is $10 for a license. You can license up to 5 computers. And the same experience of using Tonal Energy on iOS or Android can now happen on your desktop. Now this is huge because for many of us, our desktop computer is probably the one that's plugged in at the front of the room. Say we're showing videos, or putting up the agenda for the day in a keynote presentation, or exporting audio of other kinds from other apps. I know for me, the computer that's plugged in at the front of the room is the Mac. And it's for this reason that I've always had to have a separate channel in my mixer for a phone or for an iPad to get certain apps like Tonal Energy. If I'm being honest, Tonal Energy is pretty much the last daily use iOS app that I do not have on the Mac, because like many of them have been brought to the Mac over the last 5 or 6 years, notably the Fourscore app. I downloaded it. I've been poking around in it for a few minutes. It's very similar to the iOS and Android version. It responds fairly well to resizing the window, which is a thing that desktop apps can do. There are some clumsy features that you kind of have to poke around and click around weirdly to get to. And I'm not 100% sure if there are keyboard shortcuts available. If not, I'll be a little disappointed in that, but I'll live, because like most of these apps that start off strong on one platform and then eventually get ported to another, it's really, really nice to have them. So I absolutely will be using this. It right out of the box worked with my MIDI controller that's plugged into my computer setup down in my studio. Playing my MIDI controller works now just like a Yamaha Harmony Director, which I just spent some time detailing why that's useful. And I still think the Yamaha Harmony Director will continue to be as useful as I just stated that it will be. But this will definitely get use when I'm teaching out of other classrooms and my Mac is plugged into the sound system, but I just don't have access to that dedicated hardware device. So I'm very excited about this. It seems to have all of the features of the mobile app. It looks like some multi-window support. You can like sort of attach a PDF of some sheet music to a custom preset sound file that you create in the app. There seems to be some things that are worth looking into. So I'll hopefully be able to cover this in more detail later on down the road. But for now, I just wanted you to know that Tonal Energy can be downloaded on your Mac or Windows device. That's it. Enjoy the rest of the show. Welcome to Music Ed Tech Talk, a podcast exploring music, education, technology, and the intersections between them, with a special focus on the productive and creative process. I'm your host, Robbie Burns. Thanks to my sponsor this week, Light the Music. Thanks also to this month's Patreon supporters, Emmanuel and Kristen. Thanks for supporting the show. If you want to support Music Ed Tech Talk, you can head on over to patreon.com/musicedtechtalk and join one of the 4 support tiers, all of which include access to the Music Ed Tech Talk Discord server, where you can join the community in talking about those subjects and more. With me today is Ben Denne. How's it going?
Going great.
Yeah, it's good to have you back. For those who don't know, you and I work together at Ellicott Mills Middle School. You teach orchestra. And you were recently on the show within the past couple of years on the episode using relational databases to track student assessment through performance. And that, I should tell you, I think I've said it before, but that episode is, I wouldn't call it like the most listened to episode, but it's the one I get the most specific email about.
Yeah, the FileMaker database is quite daunting at best, and I imagine that there's a lot of crawl-out questions.
People, I think, like, it's because of how the file, like the relational database kind of technology piece of it is, but I think it also speaks to how many people do see the value in tracking student assessment in their own homegrown kind of solution that prioritizes the kinds of things that we talked about in that episode.
Certainly. Like, it's so hard to keep track of where all these kids are in different places. And the more you know where they are, the easier it is to move them forward. So just like trying to shine a light on those spots.
Yeah, I thought maybe what we could do is I have two like a little follow-up news-related things before we get to our main topic today. So just one piece of like music education technology news that I have anyway from the past few weeks is the release of Dorico 4. You are a Dorico user. Have you looked much into the new features of Dorico 4?
I have not had a whole lot of time to do any notation this year. So I have not upgraded past, I think, Dorico 2 at this point. So I'm behind. I'm sorry.
But you're like definitely a Dorico advocate, I would say.
In terms of note input, it's probably the fastest that I can get something on a page and in front of students.
Yeah, I would agree with that totally. And Dorico 4, and then of course like the subsequent ones in between, they've added a lot of like little tiny workflow improvements. It's the kind of thing where I feel like when you do eventually update, you're gonna feel really good about some of the things that like already make it fast to use. It's now even faster to use.
That's fantastic.
I'm going to eventually put a little blog post out there, but I'll link in the notes to this episode their own release blog post about this update. And then, of course, the Scoring Notes blog also has an extremely thorough overview of a lot of the new features, and I'll link that as well. But yeah, it's really quite good. I think probably like one of the most visually noticeable things, and it comes from their iPad release over the summer, is the introduction of what they call the key editor, which is like you can have a piano roll and your notation on the screen at the same time. Which, I don't know, this might just be because I'm kind of like a digital audio workstation snob, but like I kind of think that that's a graphically helpful way to see and adjust things like note duration.
You showed me that. That part looked really, really cool. Because so many times you're sitting here with fumbling for different keys to find different notes. And if you can just drag beginnings or endings of notes to where you want them and have them show up in notation, that is, definitely helps a little speed.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. So Dorico 4, everyone, check it out if you're into that. They offer lots of like upgrade and cross-grade pricing if you're a Finale or a Sibelius or a user of some other software. There might be a discount in it for you. Of course, also the educator discount as well. All right, main topic. We're talking about tonal energy. So I'm going to the Ohio Music Educators Association Professional Development Conference in a couple of weeks, and I'm presenting two sessions. We're actually recording about both of these topics back to back because they actually are, this first topic, teaching intonation, like this is something that we've talked about on this show, but also something that you've thought and reflected really deeply on kind of philosophically, but also in like a practical terms, like how do you actually like get student, you know, what are the tools and the strategies you're doing with students? And then the other topic, which will be released as a separate podcast episode shortly after this one, is about team collaboration and communication apps, which is like obviously like we are on the same music team using those, so it seemed like it would be natural to talk to specifically you about them. And both episodes are just kind of act as supplements to those presentations, so I can direct people who attend those sessions to these episodes for reference. And if you're going to Ohio Music Educators Conference, you know, then I hope to see you there. So I guess the area where we should probably start before we talk about like what even Tonal Energy is, it's a tuning app, but before we even get there, I've thrown in our notes just a handful of what I think to us are ideas about teaching performing arts students, like things that we take for granted because we believe them and have put them into practice. Many of these things
have done them for a decade. Right.
So for people who maybe like are not on that same page, how do you like generally sort of like in broad strokes describe your approach to and like kind of centering on of intonation in the orchestra classroom?
Well, I will tell you that I think one of the reasons that intonation is such a difficult topic is because there's really two things that are in play. One is the sound itself and how sound works in regards to other sounds. The idea of consonants and dissonance and how those sound waves interact is an incredibly complex thing. And you can go way into the weeds in trying to figure out how all the details of intonation structures work. But at the same time, you want to make it as simple as you possibly can for a middle school student or elementary school student or a high school student to put a process in place where they can find that consonance and play in tune as quickly as they can without having to think about all the details involved with all the math, because there's, you know, a ton of math and intonation and a ton of things you have to consider if you look at it from that perspective. And so I think the biggest thing you have to start with is understanding that every single note that you play is made up of all the sounds in the harmonic series. And if you don't address the tone of the note first, then you are trying to figure out how to match things that are not ever going to match up. And so our biggest thing in teaching intonation is that actually not starting with tuning, it's starting with making a beautiful sound on your instrument. So as you work toward building that tone, what happens is we perceive a good tone as one that's balanced. So the lower fundamental sounds are the strongest ones, and the harmonics as they build up through the note are all fitting in within that harmonic. And so you can hear that when you compare two sounds that are sort of like that, then you can sort of hear the dissonance or the beats that happen between those sounds. And a lot of times we'll teach intonation based on here's a tuner, just look at the tuner, make sure it says it's right. The only problem with that, well, there's a couple problems with that. The first problem is that it doesn't address the tone issue. And so a lot of times students will be practicing and playing quote in tune unquote with a bad tone, but it won't really match with what the other students are playing. It doesn't quite sound right. And two, most of the tuners, I wouldn't just say all, because we're going to talk about tonal energy, which does deal with just intonation, deal with an equal temperament system, which does not allow you to find a purely in tune interval. So if you're trying to teach students what it sounds like to be purely in tune, you can't use an equal tempered tuner for it.
It's really difficult to be able to engage deeply with any kind of tuning system until you can first make a really stable and consistent sound on an instrument. And that's sometimes like a little bit of, I guess we'll talk a little bit how tonal energy can help with that too, but that's sometimes the language I use with students even before we start to talk about like what kinds of frequency range their tone has is like, can you just make one that is the same from the start of it to the end of it?
Sure. I mean, that's the biggest problem when you're trying to deal with all these intonation structures is that tone has to be really good. And we talk about just intonation in this context. And I would say that just intonation is used mostly for me as a teaching tool. Our goal is to try to teach students how to be consonant, how to hear sounds and make it sound good without the sounds that they have around them. It's just intonation is not really an intonation system that works past a single key. So if you have anything that gets complex, then just the intonation falls apart. You can sort of move around with it somewhat, and find consonances within it. But it's mostly from an academic standpoint that we use the just intonation model. But if our goal is to teach students how to be consonant, we need to find out what causes that consonance and allows them to find it as well.
And something about focusing, you know, on a really much more specific and centered concept of pitch, you know, I think it in a way just kind of activates the ears and the listening in a way that also just to further connect intonation and tone production, you know, listening more deeply to the quality of your sound kind of raises your a level of alertness to all characteristics of the sound, intonation included. So I think a lot of times, you know, by having a specific target, by using strategies that get students to be matching pitch, ultimately what we're doing at the end of the day is teaching them how to listen, which is the thing that once carried with them will assist them in all kinds of musical contexts.
And in teaching string instruments, you're going to notice that there's a long tradition of teaching intonation by sound. Because we have all these strings that are tuned in fifths or fourths in terms of bass, you have reference pitches that will ring on string instruments. If you play, you know, if you play a G on the D string on violin, you're going to get a sympathetic resonance from that open G if it's in tune. And that sympathetic resonance will enhance the tone of the sound. So in many ways, by listening and improving the sound, you're focusing on the intonation just within the instrument itself.
Yeah, and I like what you said about making it simple for students, because I think of this, I'm not really going to like full on quote Suzuki here, but I'll carry with me the general idea. It's from Nurtured by Love. And he's talking about subconscious learning and how there is no intuition, so to speak. Like all of us have learned one way or another to develop the perspective that we have. And I think intonation, like, you don't need all the fancy math. Like, you can definitely, in a pretty concrete way, teach a student to hear the relationship of their pitch to another pitch, whether or not they know, like, how many degrees sharp or flat they are relative to that pitch or not.
Yep. And to counter your band director talking about Suzuki, I'll share a thought that I learned from Arnold Jacobs, a tuba player, who talked about the fact that when you're singing, you don't think about the muscles that happen inside of your body. You don't think about the vocal cords. You don't think about all the things that happen inside. But because we deal with things on the outside, what our hands are doing, we tend to think about them a lot more. There's no reason that necessitates us thinking about our hands more than our vocal cords. But just because they're outside of our body, we do that. And so to try to think about sound and internalize it in the same way that you think about your voice, you think about your voice going up and down in terms of sound. You don't think about in terms of manipulating your vocal cords or your all the things that work to make sound inside your body in different ways. All you think about is the goal. And so you have that same ability, whether it's with your fingers or your lips or all those different things that you do to create a sound, without having to think about them. You can think about the sound and let the sound control those muscles in your body.
So in my experience, it would seem that on the whole, a lot of pedagogy is discussed with almost, you know, when I did this session most recently, like I put a list of, you know, when we go to our local orchestra and band assessments here, we're judged by some judges using this sheet of paper that has some musical criteria on it. And amongst these words are like tone, intonation, balance, technique, expression. Like these are some of the criteria we use to kind of talk about music in our context. But I asked the teachers in the session to kind of order them in terms of musical priority for me. And like without, you know, like no one really, you know, how do I say this? Like most of the people in the room, like put tone first, followed by either balance or intonation. And then sort of like the things that we associate more with technique, like rhythm and accuracy and pitch, those came like lower on the list. But a lot of times in practice, I kind of see teaching style that sort of reflects actually the opposite of that, sort of like starting from the other end, like rhythmic focused, accuracy, like fingering, you know, what is all these other external features of like what the body is doing. Why do you think it is so unpopular to focus on sound in the classroom?
I think it's because it takes time. Whenever you are trying to make a sound better, you need note durations to last, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds at a minimum to be able to hear them. And there's not a lot of students that are really, really interested in playing whole notes all the time. And so you end up with having music that is more complex than you want it to have when you're teaching intonation, because it's moving too fast. They can't have time to hear those things. And then the rhythmic accuracy becomes important, because if they're not playing notes at the same time, you can't compare the notes because they're not happening at the same time. So you lose that ability. So you start thinking as a teacher, I've got to make sure all of these rhythms line up before I can start teaching them in time, because they're not there. But really what you have to do is take those notes out of context, find the chords within the pieces, and then elongate them and treat them like whole notes or double whole notes. And so they can hold them for long durations. They can and investigate what those sounds sound like. And eventually, what happens is the student's ability to adjust gets faster. It might be that they start by not being able to adjust at all, and then they might be able to find consonants in 5 seconds, then maybe 4 seconds, and then maybe it gets a little faster, and then they can find a consonant in a second or a half second. And then finally they get to the point where they can anticipate where the consonant is going to be, and then they can play an eighth note in tune. But it doesn't happen very quickly in that regard. It takes a long time to build that skill before you're going to see it in an ensemble piece that moves quickly, because you have to get to that anticipatory step before you can play something that goes quickly and get it right, because it won't be time to adjust.
Yeah, I guess this is, unless there's stuff you want to address before this, I guess this is a good time to sort of talk about, you know, using tuning drones in the classroom. And then maybe kind of explain like what are the features of tonal energy specifically that make working with tuning drones easier to do.
Well, tuning drones are helpful because they mimic a consonance that we're trying to achieve. So in an orchestra or a band rehearsal, you have some people who are playing a harmony line and some people who are playing a melody line, and you want that melody line to be consonant with the harmony line. The problem is that a lot of times our low strings and low winds are not holding a consistent sound. So they're wobbling a little bit. Maybe the low brass doesn't have a good breath. And so it's just wobbling a little back and forth. Maybe the low strings are getting a little scratchy tone because the basses can't keep the tip of the bow up straight. And so in a really good reference for what you're trying to tune to, it's very, very difficult because it wobbles around. It's not going to be as consistent, especially among those beginning students. And so what the drone does is it says, all right, here is that really strong fundamental pitch. It's a balanced tone, and we're going to use it as a basis for how we're going to compare our melodies to our harmonies. So now if I'm playing a melody, a melodic instrument, or any instrument can be played as a melodic instrument, if you're playing a melody, then you can listen to the drone as a harmony that's consistent and stable, and it becomes a little bit easier to anticipate where your note is going to be, especially if you go back and forth within scale degrees, and you get used to what it sounds like to play the fifth in tune, what it sounds like to play the fourth in tune. And then as you gradually get better, the thirds and the sixth, and then the secondary ones like the second and the seventh, a little bit more difficult because it's a complex intonation, but you can get there by finding that consistency in the drone that might not happen in the rehearsal the way you're running it.
Yeah, and we tend to use drones like as much as we possibly can throughout instruction. I try to have one running as, you know, almost all of my rehearsals, anything that's being played in a sectional or in a group, even just with one-on-one with a student. And we like to turn them up loud. Actually, I should say too, before we talk about tonal energy, when I first met you, you and Dr. Richard Roberts, the current band director at the school, had actually provided a resource for students to like work with these, even in their home practice, by like basically recording the output of a Dr. Beat tuning drone into... You basically created a tuning CD, which was like 3-minute audio recordings of every single drone pitch on a Dr. Beat.
It wasn't even 3 minutes. It was like 1 minute. We only had 72 minutes to work with.
That's right. Right. So
on a CD. So yeah, we took the Dr. Beat because that was the drone that we were using in class. And we just created a 1 minute long track for each note and burned hundreds and hundreds of CDs to hand out to students so they could take them home and practice with drones at home. And then I think it's 2007, we finally were able to put it online and make it a little easier to access from the students' perspective.
And then enter the mobile smartphone and this kind of, I mean, Dr. Beat is like $140, you know, the model at least that was popular around that time. So like now you can for, you know, between $4 and $7 or $8, you can get something like Tonal Energy, which is gonna make that drone experience, even if all you're using it for is just to simply pump a loud drone through some speakers, even just that experience is gonna give you a much finer degree of quick manipulation between notes. It's gonna allow you to change the sound of the drone itself, because the Dr. Beat sound is like, it's a little aggressive.
And the other thing that changed is you used to have be a bigger barrier to have a device. More people have devices now than you know, 10, 15 years ago by a long shot. You can say, yeah, it's a $4 app, $5. I'm not sure how much they're charging for Tonal Energy these days, but it used to be like, there's this app, but you have to get a device first. And if you don't have a device, then that was the financial thing you had to overcome. And for much of my career, it was still much cheaper to get a Dr. Beat at $140 than it was to get a device. And, you know, eventually the app was going to come along with it. But because so many students have access to devices and in various ways, then the app becomes a much more accessible thing. Although I will say what's interesting is we haven't talked too much about the blend and balance issue. We talked about tone, but in order to compare two sounds, they have to be about the same volume. And there's two ways to do this. One is by playing it through a set of speakers that are fairly loud. This is, I think, the better way to do this, because the sound waves have a chance to interact in space, and you get to hear the result of that interaction in space. And then the way that most students choose to use it is by putting headphones on and hearing the drones in the headphones. And so you still get to hear the consonants between the sound that you're producing and the headphones, but it's not quite as palpable of a sound as if you're playing it through speakers.
Yeah, and if you already touched on this, sorry to repeat it, but like what we're essentially doing with these drones is we are teaching students to actually hear the beats that result from two slightly out of tune pitches, not only starting with unisons, like having a drone on a B-flat 4 and then a, you know, a trumpet player on a B-flat 4 and then like matching that note. But then if that student plays the B-flat major scale, you know, the third scale degree, the fifth scale degree, like every scale degree is going to have a specific spot where it matches the harmonic series of the B-flat. And so you can actually tune to eliminate the beats out of any interval along to that drone. So it's not just like warming up the ensemble, matching some pitches. It's like learning short folk melodies, like all of our concert music. I give them, you know, tuning note references that they should practice along to, like pretty much anything we're doing.
Right. And as you're thinking about the beats, again, they're caused by the harmonic interference between two sound waves. If they're exactly the same, the peaks and the troughs of the waves line up and it becomes a little bit louder. But if they're not quite the same, then they go in phase and out of phase. And when they're in phase, it sounds a little bit louder. When they're out of phase, it sounds a little softer. And so what you hear when you hear those beats are the raising and lowering of volume. The more notes in common in the harmonic series with the note you're trying to tune to, the more the stronger the beat will be. So the more naturally consonant notes that you have, the octaves, the unisons, the fourths, the fifths, they're going to have more notes in common within the harmonic series. So the beats are going to be much more than the ones that are more dissonant, all the way to the tritone, which has very, very few notes in common until it gets to the really high harmonics. And so those are going to be very, very difficult. Right. And then there's things like the seventh, which we have, you know, you're going to hear beats related to the secondary chord. So the seventh in the scale functions more as a third in the dominant than it does in as a seventh in the major scale, because in the major scale, the seventh tends to be played a little bit higher, leading to the octave, versus an adjusted intonation system, that seventh is going to be a little bit lower to be more consonant. And so you'll have things like that are slightly different. But once you get to the point where students hear those consonances on the basic intervals, I mean, if you can get the major chord in your ensembles to sound perfectly in tune, that's going to go a long, long way to the perception of your ability to teach intonation.
Yeah, yeah, totally. So let me actually, now that you've filled that in a little bit, let me come back to Tonal Energy, but sort of just give some stats for those who are completely unfamiliar with this app. Tonal Energy is available on iOS and Android. It's one of the things that I should say is that, like, our students, for the most part, you know, don't have, like, most of our students are able to access some sort of mobile device in their home and use this. You can actually install an Android app on a Chromebook, which is what our students are given by our school district. However, mileage may vary in your district, like what kinds of restrictions are on the Play Store. Like, I don't think we've been able to get any of our students to successfully run this on their school-issued computer. I think most of them are using some sort of personal device. And what Tonal Energy is offering is these stable drones, but the drones can, you can change the sound of the drones. You can play them. It's, you know, it's a polyphonic drone. So you can, like, play a chord. You can change the tuning system. You can have it be an, you know, play a, put a, you know, a C, an E, and a G into it. Change it to, you know, sound like a euphonium, and then put it in equal temper tuning or just intonation. And then it's like one of the most fully featured metronomes I've seen on the App Store, and it as a standalone metronome is itself worth the cost. But then you can also play these chords and simultaneously run a metronome, which is, I think, how we both often will use it while we're teaching. And the metronome itself, we're not going to talk as much about it today, but I mean, it is able to subdivide the beat in every which way. Many, many time signature options are presented. You can change. One of the things I really like about it as a percussion private teacher is that you actually, I use this in the band classroom too, is it, of all the metronomes that will actually have a voice that says 1, 2, 3, 4 as the counting sound, Tonal Energy sounds the most human in its counting sound. And it's like, I remember, like, being a fourth grader myself and being told, like, count out loud while you play, count out loud. And I always try to remember why I hated doing that so much. I don't know if I believe that being able to count out loud, make, you know, while you play something makes you a better musician, but I do know that the idea of having a very, very assertive and percussive human-sounding voice counting the beats gives you a strong sense of place in, you know, metrically inside of the time that you're playing in. And that's, and not even...
I'll add in, as I was working with Tonal Energy with orchestra, we had a piece this week in 7/8, and I was just coming through the options, and there's 2+2+3, there's 3+2+2, it's 2+3+2. You can add accents to the big beats. You can control that in a very, very easy way. It's one of those metronomes that has a very, very accurate press to start time. So if you hit your start button right when you want it to start, it'll start right when you want it to start. The same thing is true when it changes tempos. You can get the next tempo lined up and hit enter when you want it to change, and it racks very, very quickly, which is really nice on the metronome.
That's a good point. Yeah, if I'm rehearsing the band and the metronome is plugged in and they're like, tempo is a little rocky, sometimes I will like start using the giant tap tempo button to whatever speed we're currently rehearsing and then hit the play button right on the next one. And it's like as if the metronome is accompanying them rather than them it, because of how responsive it is to my finger. It's just like, and we're going to talk more about this when we talk about like MIDI keyboards and stuff. You know, it's a very performable app. You can like play along with students on the drones. I know sometimes you like to like slide your finger along the little circle wheel of notes and play melodies along with your, you know, your students. Yeah. The metronome is real powerful. It even has a sequencer. Like you can say play four measures of 4/4 at 120 and then two measures of 7/8 at 130 and then play a measure of 1/1 at 20 beats per minute. Like you can just totally program out your whole thing. But yeah, so back to these drones though. I mean, I know you have some opinions on using certain instruments. Or like, do you have a couple of favorite instrument sounds that you think help your students to hear the frequency range best?
It's really interesting because a lot of students, because I teach strings, will go right to the string sounds. But Tonal Energy started the string sounds with a saw wave, and they've improved it dramatically. But it still has a lot of bright harmonics in that sound. And if you're trying to tune and find consonants, you want a sound that is a better balanced sound. I think one time we went into Audacity and we said, all right, let's build a tone of the harmonic series. And we found that if you gradually reduce each harmonic by a little bit more every single time, it starts with the fundamental being the strongest, and then the second harmonic was maybe a third of that volume, and then like almost looked like a logarithmic curve as it went back down to very, very small, you could hear a really, really strong balanced sound. And so when I look at these apps, I'm looking for a sound that is as balanced as I possibly can. And in the Tonal Energy app, the brass sound is the more balanced of the ones that they have in that. And so even though I teach orchestra and I teach string players, I'll sometimes stay away from the string sounds because I'm looking for a more balanced tone than that.
Cool. All right. I want to talk about some strategies for how we are using this in practice. But first, I would like to tell you about Light the Music. Light the Music empowers educators to ignite student creativity and collaboration. Using a digital audio workstation, students learn about the fundamentals of music while creating their own music that is authentic, relevant, and meaningful to them. Light the Music provides a curriculum aligned with the creating standard of the National Core Art Standards. As students are introduced to the technology tools, they create an artist's profile to guide their work throughout the curriculum. Students then learn about the elements that make up a piece of music: rhythm, chords, bass, and melody. They learn concepts by recreating and remixing, then use that knowledge to create something new. In each lesson, students share their work with classmates to give and receive feedback that is kind, specific, honest, and helpful. The Light the Music curriculum comprises 8 units and 26 lessons, containing virtual tutorials, templates, resources, and slides to make teaching easy. In each lesson, students learn, practice, and apply new skills. The curriculum offers a scaffolded structure for teachers to sequence lessons, yet contains enough flexibility for students to get support or dive deeper when desired. Students will work together towards creating their own piece of music and a video to go along with it. At the conclusion of 8 units, students share their work in a final showcase. Light the Music is ideal for students in 6th through 12th grade general music, music technology, music appreciation, or any other music courses where student creativity is the goal. Additional standalone lesson plans for teachers looking for a one-time project are also available. If you'd like to learn more, check out lightthemusic.com. Now, Light the Music sponsored the last episode. I've actually had some opportunity to dig in to some of these lessons in my general music classes over the past few weeks since doing that. I've got some thoughts on this. I'm curious to hear your thoughts on this. I'm like, now that we live in sort of post-COVID is not the right word because that we don't live in a post-COVID world, but we certainly live in a world where we've like got all teachers sort of like thinking about the sort of digital structures that underlie their class. I think I'm seeing more of this kind of thing pop up, like almost like modular lesson content creators who are producing resources for teachers where you can accept the product as the whole total package, or you can really, really easily take bits and sort of like put them together in a modular way inside of your existing structures. Like we use Canvas, for example. And one of the things I've had a lot of success with this week is I've been putting some of these Light the Music lessons to the test in that class. And, you know, the first couple of lessons were, you know, like we've had already done a lot of that stuff earlier in the year. And it was like easier than imaginable to just, you know, skip to a certain unit and then using Canvas sort of create a module that sequenced that in the context of the other stuff I was doing. So I don't know. I see this being like a really kind of moving forward in education and technology. I see this being like a really interesting space for people to make things that teachers can really easily adopt. Because like, there's a lot of stuff in these like the music plans where it's like, I could have made it, but like, did I? I didn't. Like, it's so much better to have someone who took the time to painstakingly like put the images and the Google slide presentations together and to like organize the written and also like the video and audio resources to like plan the lessons. Like, it's all stuff that you can immediately and logically see its place. It, in a sense, you get to sort of like fit it into your own context, which I think is, I don't know, I'm interested by this idea. Does this resonate with you at all?
Yeah, for me, it's all about like closing those feedback loops. And the biggest barrier often is how quickly we can get feedback to students in a process. So anytime that you can find a technology that encloses a concept or a process from the introduction of the process or the concept all the way through to completion and some sort of feedback that doesn't require the teacher input, yet is still engaging to the student and it helps move them forward, that's going to be a really, really positive thing to include in your classes.
And it's really, it's like very time efficient too, because like, it's the kind of thing where it's like the concepts in the sequence was already in my head, but the time to actually create the engaging student end of it was not there. And so like, anytime I can avoid reinventing the wheel, I will avoid reinventing the wheel. And I don't at all say that to say that like I want canned lesson plans. Like, I'm not trying to just follow a script. That doesn't make me feel like a teacher or a human being or a creative person. But the idea that something can sort of be modular is, I don't know, I'm interested to see where this goes in the future. And I definitely know that some people listening will want to go check out Light the Music, especially if you are like us teaching band and orchestra, and maybe you like have a general music or some other sort of adjacent kind of music class in your schedule.
Well, we're past the point where teachers have all the information and it's up to us to pass everything on thing on to students. We're much at the point where much of the information and much of the tools are available in a variety of places. And our job is to more go through all of those different resources and present the ones that get the results that we're looking at. So if, you might look at it as the canned lesson plan, or you can look at it as a collection of opportunities that you are going through and putting in front of your students in the right order, in the right way, to move them forward.
Yeah, I actually really resonate with that idea of me as being kind of like a curator of experiences for students. Like, in a world where so much information is given to us algorithmically, I think that what has really grounded me to my own sense of like learning new things, but also my sense of identity is just having like making relationships with people who, you know, I like to curate my own life, so to speak. And I like to surround myself with people who, you know, I don't want like Twitter or Facebook telling me what music to listen to or what news article to read. Like, I want to like find the people who will tell me. And it's kind of like, I don't know, it brings like the humanity back into the process while also taking advantage of all of the like rich and sometimes overwhelming content that is available on the internet.
Yeah, it saves a lot of time not going down rabbit holes. And students have the same issue because they don't know what the goals are. They don't know what the end result is. And so having someone to help walk them down the path or show them a path will help a lot.
All right, let's talk about, so I mean, there's like lots of specific strategies that you can use this philosophy and this app to, you know, there are lots of things you can do with this app in practice. I'm wondering, what are some of your favorites?
Well, the bare minimum is, here is the root pitch of the scale. We're in the key of G major. Here's a G. We're going to work on scale degrees. We're going to find songs that are well within the key of G major. They don't go outside of those tonal pitches. They land on dominants or tonics. They give you plenty of opportunities. They don't go too fast. And so we have a lot of these songs, some of them from the beginning of Suzuki books, some of them from method books, where you can stay in the same key and just listen to each note with a reference pitch to find that consonance and try to drill not only the understanding of that consonance, but also create those neural pathways between the muscle memory and the auditory image that you have in your head. So much of what we try to do is try to connect those over and over again in the same pathway. I often look at it like, I tell the students, it's like a forest. If you're going through a forest, you might not find the most direct route from one end to the other. But if you keep going and there's a light shining into that forest and you can sort of follow that light, eventually that you're going to form a path and it's going to be the most direct path from one end to the entrance of the forest to the exit of the forest. And if you keep doing that with a light on, eventually you're going to turn off the light and you're going to still see the path that you've drawn. And our minds work much the same way. If you every single time you hear a pitch and your fingers go to a certain point on the violin, or your lips go to a certain formation on a brass instrument, or all these different muscular things happen to make the sound correct, and it happens the same way every single time, then what happens is the brain puts a connection between the sound that you hear in your head and the result that you get from the muscles. And that is the connection that allows us to be able to do this quickly, allows us to do it accurately, helps us to do it in a variety of different situations. So the very basic thing is just hearing a drone and hearing basic melodies with that drone and trying to find out how quickly you can make that connection.
Now, you mentioned earlier, that this is so much about teaching sound oversight, but I think that we both believe that there is a time and a place to see kind of like how some of these visual tools do have relationships to the audio.
Right. I know sight is one of those things that can be really, really dangerous. At the same time, it can be really helpful, but you have to use it the correct way. I see all the time string instructors putting tapes on an instrument, and that gives them a rough idea of where that's going to be in tune. But if you think about it, a half step is 100 cents. And on a string instrument, a half step is a centimeter away from one finger to the next. And then it's at an angle where you can't really see the difference between one centimeter to the next. And then you have divide that by 20 to find out whether it's be in tune or not, because we can hear intonation to 5 cents really easily. So like things like tapes and stuff will, I like putting one marker to put your hand in the right spot, maybe a first finger tape, so you can feel where the first finger goes. But beyond that, you don't want them to be looking at their fingers. All it does is it causes them to move their instrument, if you're playing violin or viola, to the center of their body and make it really hard to get a good posture. And it takes their eyes, their focus away from the sound, and it puts on the vision. But there are some visual learners, and there's some ways that can be really, really helpful. One thing that you didn't mention in Tonal Energy is the analysis feature. The analysis feature of Tonal Energy is incredibly powerful, not only because you can see pitch going by in real time, but because you can set it for a just intonation system as well as an equal temperance system. So you can put a tuning note on and listen to it in headphones, play a scale and watch the analysis and see how close you are to finding every note in tune. And if you're watching, a green line, go and find that tuning spot being perfectly in tune while you're listening to a reference pitch, then you make a connection between, oh, that's what the in-tune sound's supposed to be. I can find that a little bit easier now. And then you can get to the point where you can use the analysis tool, but not look at it, record it, and then see how well you did in terms of tuning after the process. So it can go all the way from, the very first step all the way to an assessment, a self-assessment tool to see how well you're playing in tune.
Yeah, totally. I use that feature as well. It's its own tab in the app. And you can actually, if you're a student, you can record yourself playing whatever it is you're practicing along to the drone and actually listen back to it right from within the app, which is kind of a cool thing.
Yeah, you can do that. You can put the drone in headphones and have it just record your sound. You can do a lot of different variations of that tool.
Yeah, totally. Well, one of the things I like to do is either play along with students or create practice materials. And what's interesting about Tonal Energy is, it kind of acts as a software instrument if you plug in either a Bluetooth or a wired MIDI controller into it. And my favorite one of these is called the X Key. I will link it in the notes to this episode. And it is a little, it's a skinny little MIDI keyboard that it does not have weighted keys. It's not even really, it's really designed more for input of notes in a notation editor than it is actually performing, because it's not really a performance-friendly device. But the keys are the full width of piano keys, and it's kind of got this, if you've ever seen the Apple Magic Keyboard, it's designed in that kind of same aesthetic. It's like a sleek silver thing with white things kind of protruding out of it. So it looks really nice on your desk. It's actually small enough to carry it even around a room if you have it on Bluetooth. So I like to use it because what it can do is it actually can play the drones of Tonal Energy. And this, is really cool for doing harmony. So playing a drone in the left hand, and then if a student is, for example, playing, hot cross buns, you can play that in the right hand while holding the drone pitch down in your left hand. And then all of a sudden they're hearing a perfect model of that justly in tune using this great, tuning sound that is a balanced tuning sound. which is cool. And a lot of people might be aware of, there's actually a product made by Yamaha called the Harmony Director. And I think they actually, since I first gave this talk, I think there's actually now like a cheaper one on the market, like something closer to $700, which is not really cheap, but it's more affordable than the old one, which is like well over $1,000. And what this thing does is more or less, it is like a, it's like a piano keyboard that it's not just MIDI, but it can also just like pump drones through your speaker system if you plug it into your speaker system. And then you have like an array of buttons on the top surface of it that can change which key area it's in tune, you know, it's playing justly in tune. So that's kind of an interesting but expensive product. It makes performing the drones feel a little bit more tactile, like a, you know, closer to like a real synthesizer. But for most purposes, I find that this little Bluetooth X key is really good. And what's really good about it is that Tonal Energy is the brains of it. And Tonal Energy is far more, gives far more control and power to you than something like the Yamaha. In fact, they can even, because it's an app on the App Store, they can push updates out. They can add features to it by updating the app. So one of the things I like, for example, is that Tonal Energy will actually, it can automatically shift key center based on what chord you're playing. So like I can be playing a B flat chord and it can be set to automatically detect that is a B flat major chord and then lower the third slightly and make other kinds of like harmonic adjustments relative to like what notes I'm playing on top of the B flat root. But then if I like play an A major chord, it can like shift the whole intonation of the chord into the key area of A based on that root. And it can do this all live based on which fingers you're pushing down. So I love using this feature. I use it playing along live with my students, but I also will sometimes like record myself playing like a scale or a short melody or something I've assigned a student, and then I'll release it to them as a practice track on our website.
And thank you for mentioning that the X key was Bluetooth. I was wondering how that connection would work because I used the output from my device to power the speakers. So having the X key connected to the Tonal Energy through Bluetooth allows it to connect without having to sacrifice your output to speakers.
It's cool too, because you can kind of like, if you want to, you can kind of work the room. You can walk around with it while you're playing it and it'll connect to, I usually use it in combination with my iPad, which is fun. And speaking of the iPad and making play-along tracks, I have a blog post, which I will put in the notes to this episode, talking about how to make your own. And what's really fun is, so in the same way that like Logic Pro or Ableton Live has like a plugin system where you can like take third-party software instruments and reverbs and stuff and sort of like plug them into your project, GarageBand for the iPad and for the iPhone has a plugin system. And it's like basically an audio extension system. And Tonal Energy plays really nice with this. So you can actually play the X key into Tonal Energy and set it up in GarageBand as its own software instrument. So basically, like, you're recording the sound of yourself into a project. And then you can get real fun. You can, like, add in a drum beat. You can add in a bass. You can add it. You can, like, change the style of the music and make it just, like, a more vibrant, fun, and engaging thing. I've actually, shameless self-promotion, I made a series of play-along tracks that are justly in tune and that follow along like some 808 bass and trap beats. And that tends to be fun for my students during our warmups.
And it's interesting. Some things like, there's little hacks within Tonal Energy. For instance, if I played a chord, here's a G major chord, for instance, right? And it's in just intonation. And it's an upper of a chord, but I go down to the bottom octave and then I double tap a D in the bottom. It'll change to a D major chord. And because I'm using a lower octave to change it, it doesn't change the structure of the chord that I have. But I can go back and forth with all these different chords. And especially when the music is going back in different keys, you know, often goes to the second half, it goes into development. It goes to the dominant, or the second theme goes to the dominant. And you can go to another chord really, really easily while a student's playing.
Yeah, right on. I actually didn't know the double tap feature, so I'm writing that down right now. Yeah, and there's like lots of things you can use in combination if you want to get real creative with your play-along tracks. I'm using the Band in a Box app lately. I don't know if you've heard that through the door of your office.
Yes.
Some of our warm-ups have been in this like bluegrass style or like disco lately, or even there's a march. You can basically get real creative and fun with how you make these.
Robbie is the most creative with his concert band, and he teaches that third period when I'm teaching a sectional. So I miss a lot of the most creative stuff that he does.
Oh, you know what? It is probably getting more mileage out of our warmups in the concert band. That's probably why you're not hearing quite as much of them. Yeah. Yeah. So there's just like tons of resources out there. One thing I also like to do is, and I can't like for legal reasons really share this anywhere, but there's a great It's kind of like a choir teaching resource. I think it's designed to be sort of left in the hands of a substitute teacher. Actually, to be fair, I'm going to describe this resource. I've never even read the book. I just bought it for the CD that comes with it. It's called Solfege Bingo. And it's a bunch of like, it's like a someone singing short three-note solfege patterns. And the idea is that there's equal space in between each singing pattern. So you're supposed to have your choir sing each pattern back as a warm-up. But then you can like hand out these bingo cards and have them like put down a little chip on which pattern they hear, which seems obvious if you're trying to match syllables. But like then there's like an accompaniment track version of each sound recording that is a clarinet playing the pattern instead of someone singing it, so that you like have to actually like use your awareness of the scale degrees rather than the syllables. And what I'll do is I've actually transposed these exercises into band keys and added a drone to them in GarageBand so that I have these like kind of these solfege teaching tools, which is another fun thing.
But thank you for mentioning singing, because I can't believe we're talking about intonation this long and not mentioning singing. It's such an important part of this process. My students will tell you that they get a lot of listen, sing, play in that order. And so they have an idea of what that sounds like in their head before they try to play it. The imaginary step, the audio imagination that you have, oral imagination is what I want to say. Oral imagination step is a very, very important step in that process, because if they can anticipate what it's going to sound like before they have a chance to play it, it's going to be much more accurate. But as a teaching standpoint, the singing is also going to tell you whether the problem is a technique-based problem on their instrument, or if it's a conception-based problem within their minds. If they can't hear it, then they're going to have a really, really hard time producing on their instrument. And most students will be able to produce with their voice anything they can hear. There's a few students that still struggle with that connection, but most students who are sufficient talkers have a strong connection between their voice and the sounds in their head. And so by and large, that's a huge tool to help see whether they can understand pitches the way you want them to. A lot of times they don't like singing because they're not sure about their voice. They haven't tried it out a whole bunch. Even humming or things like that can be a way to get them matching pitch before that full-blown singing happens in your classroom.
Yeah, totally. And something actually I've tried, speaking in my concert band, they have definitely been kind of like, it's been like a sandbox or a playground for me to experiment with a lot of my new teaching ideas. And something that really went a long way for us earlier this year is, you know, like with our concert band, there are musicians who are dominantly sixth graders, though we do accept all grades into that class. A lot of these students had experienced really only just some, like maybe a little over half a year of in-person fourth grade teaching, and then were virtual or hybrid all the rest of that first school year, and then all of fifth grade. So these are students who have never really been in this kind of environment where they're like not only like matching their sound to what they hear, but also like with like, you know, 50 or so other students all trying to sort of like work together on these ensemble basics of balance, blend, intonation, and tone. So what often is the case when you're trying to meet a group with such mixed levels of skill like that is to, you know, program easier music for them to play. And so my solution always when I have struggles is to go and raid some of my elementary school teachers' friends' libraries and find, like, I'll ask them, like, what did you play on your fourth grade concert? And they'll say, oh, this one, this one, this one. And I'll take them and I'll bring them back in. And, you know, sixth graders can, like, really knock, like, some beginning basic band pieces out of the park. Well, this year, I was like, okay, but, like, even still, there was, like, some struggle with splitting into different parts, like having two or three different things in the music happening at a time. So something that worked really well for me was to take some of our fall concert music and write everybody's part for every instrument with solfege underneath of the notes. And so our whole like beginning of the year it became kind of like a warm-up structure, but it also was something that we did like really for in the early weeks of the year, like almost for the full duration of class, is we would like sing and play unison melodies as if we were working out of a method book. But what they didn't realize until later was they were actually learning their music for the concert and everybody else's parts. So you have this other like sort of pedagogical benefit of now when they do split up into different parts, they've developed more confidence on their melodic line by playing it with 65 other people. But now they also are hearing the relationship of, say, like a flute's part to the tuba part.
And that's so valuable for students that don't get to play melodies very often. So many times in your ensembles, the students that don't get the melodies will not get the same level of education because they don't get challenged in the same way. So by having everybody play all the parts, you get a much more strong continuity in your instruction from instrument to instrument, which I think is an incredibly important part of teaching.
And this actually does logically connect in my head to the next thing in the outline, which is hardware, because I feel like in this teaching style for the concert band, in combination with some of our last year virtual hardware, which we've now put up at the front of the room, has really helped me to be so much better of a teacher. I'm talking about specifically our audio interface, our higher quality microphone, and then we bought a wireless Shure headset microphone. And that, plus our computer audio output, plus our phone Tonal Energy audio output, is all in like three different channels of a mixer up at the front of the room, where you can kind of mix and balance the voice, the drone, and any other play along resources to taste. And then I can take my iPad with my seating chart and my sheet music and walk around the room. And, you know, like, it's so easy to, like, if I have this like trap beat going on throughout everything, it's so easy to just say 1, 2, 3 again. And like, we're just, you know, grinding on these 8 to 16 measure long melodic fragments while I can like high five someone on their way in the room, or like help fix some trombone posture, or any one of these other things. So it's like, also this, there's a classroom management piece to it as well.
Right. Or if you're an orchestra director, tune all the instruments that need to get tuned.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And your like voice is just as present. You know, I can talk in the volume I'm talking now and be heard above all 60 kids and the play along tracks I'm pumping through the speakers.
Yeah. I mean, that automated warm up where you can be off the podium and have them working on things allows so much more productive time at the beginning of class, because there's so many things that get in the way of being productive at the beginning of your class. And so to have something that is that strongly pedagogically sound, and soundly pedagogically sound, that's not good, that pedagogically sound, and being able to adopt it in a way that solves all the logistical problems and yet moves the class forward in a very strong way is really cool.
Yeah, totally. It's been a win. I've got some resources here at the end. I feel like we didn't necessarily reference them all. I'll dump some like supplemental stuff in the show notes that we didn't talk about. Do you want to talk about your thesis at all? I feel like that's kind of relevant.
I did a master's degree at University of Maryland, College Park. And one of the things I did for my thesis was to try to test to see whether these drones were effective in teaching intonation. And so I had set up a control group and an experimental group, and picked a key center that, you know, we wouldn't be working on that often. I think I chose like F sharp major or something like that, and told the students that we're going to learn how to play the scale and tune. And I gave one group of students the drone instruction to work with, and I had a recording of how to play, like a play along recording that they had to follow, that had all of the drones and had all the intonation resources built in, and a second one for a control group that had the same method of terms of what they had to do to play, but did not have the drone or the intonation resources in place. And so I was able to measure the difference between those two groups. And it was significant. I mean, there were some students that were in control group that were still successful because they were able to relate it to other intonation things that they'd been working on in class, and that they had found success. And there were still a few students in the experimental group that, you know, sometimes it takes time. It does not happen instantaneously to hear pitch. And so that didn't quite get it, but the results were still significant. There was much, much more improvement when they had these tools than when they didn't. And so it's not going to solve every single one of your problems. It's not going to make it happen overnight. This does take a lot of time because every student has a different pace, and every student has a different basis. Some people live with families that speak in a very, very non-tonal sort of way. It has like a monotone sound. They're not used to hearing pitch going up and down in their speaking voice. They speak with a very monotone speaking voice. And so there's not a whole lot of singing in their house. There's not a lot of pitch work done. In some houses, students have very, very expressive voices in both their parents and themselves. They have a whole bunch of things that are in pitch. They have songs that they sing along all the time. And they're going to get there a lot faster than the students that don't have any reference with pitch. And that's going to happen. But this will help.
I'm glad you also wrapped that up into a conclusion statement, because I'm bad at doing conclusion statements. I always ask myself, why do I need to? But that actually was really nice. So thank you for that. Every episode does feature an album, app, and tech tip of the week. Have you thought about this at all? Do you want to do album or app first?
Do app of the week.
Okay, cool. Well, I've got one. A couple of episodes ago, you can hear me and Dr. David McDonald talk about craft, which is one of many, it kind of falls into this category of like personal knowledge management. You can use it for writing, you can use it for notes. I also have been using something called Obsidian, which is a really similar competing tool. You can hear me talk about that on the most recent episode of the show, the holiday special. All of these tools, one of their strengths is sort of the ability to interconnect different bits of information. So like in these tools, you can reference a note inside of another note. And what I like about this kind of modular approach is that you can, like there are apps out there that have a similar function. So like, even though I use Obsidian for taking notes, well, OmniFocus, which is where I make little checkable tasks, you can take a project or a task and then create a link straight into that project or task. And so what I've been doing a lot of lately is kind of like building an app out of lots of different apps. So taking the best of each app and then kind of stringing them all together with breadcrumbs. So like inside of a note that I have about this very podcast recording might be links to some other reference notes, like the blog post I'm going to publish about it. But it also has a link out to an OmniFocus project with checkable tasks to remind me like all the things I have to do to publish this show correctly. And so I like this idea of sort of like deep linking content from some parts of my computer to other parts. And there's a really cool app I've been using this week called Hook. It's for the Mac. And what it does is somehow it integrates with just a humongous variety of different apps on the Mac, some that are Apple made, some that are not. And what you do is you invoke a little keyboard shortcut. Mine is Shift Command Spacebar. And then it pops up a little menu to show you what content was just in the foreground. And then it allows you to basically copy a link to that to your clipboard and then paste it into something else. And it does like way more than that, but that's kind of like my experimental level that I've engaged with it so far. So for example, like Nicole Sobel, who teaches band at our school with us, we were like preparing some materials to send out to our elementary school directors about like coming up in the band in the sixth grade. And like there was like a Slack message thread between the two of us about like some things that she had asked me to do. There was like a document she had shared with me. I had a draft in like my notes for like the email message I was going to send. And these are all like in different apps. But with Hook, I could just create little links to all of them and then like put them in the, you know, notes field of the task. The task is like, you know, send out elementary school feeder email or something. But then like if I, you know, need to reference one of those documents, I have all these quick links to them and they take me directly to the data. So that's kind of what I'm into this week.
Awesome. My app of the week is called, the website is janus.io. And this is an app that allows you to do audio over the internet with really low latency, which really means in real time. And so I had been investigating this because, you know, we're looking at not having everything be in person, and can you actually have, you know, quartets rehearsed together at their house? Can you do all these kind of things? And it is possible. And actually, it works much better than I thought it would be. It's an open source free piece of software, which is really cool. And they have, when you download the program, there's a whole bunch of people who have set up public rooms. You can pick up a public room, and I was able to get, and they say that you have to have hardwired to the internet. I'm running it on Wi-Fi, and I was still able to get a ping time down to 8 milliseconds and a delay of like between 30 and 40 milliseconds with no jitter, which is really, really impressive. You're not going to notice much under 50 milliseconds. You think about it in terms of how fast that is. You know, a quarter note at quarter note equals 60 is 1 second. So, you know, a 16th note would be a quarter second or 250 milliseconds. At 120, that's 125 milliseconds. So you're talking about faster than a 30-second note at 120, which is a pretty, pretty quick response in terms of getting sound over through the internet. And I was playing, you know, this with just a couple of easy jazz charts with someone in DC and someone in Toronto, and it was working, which is really cool. There's also, you can go on to, for not much money at all, I think I spent like $2, go on Amazon Cloud Services and build a stack, and Jamulus has ready to upload stuff. You can just, with a couple of buttons, set up your own server on Amazon with your own IP address that's private. And I was able to, with a hardwire connection, get that down to like 3 milliseconds with a 20 millisecond delay, which is amazing in terms of that. The one barrier to that is that trying to get people who are less technology proficient on it is a little more difficult. You do need to have a laptop. It does not work on iOS yet, and it does not work on Android, but it does work. And the proof of concept is there, which is very exciting to me.
Yes. I knew that we weren't going to realize that vision, which so many musicians have, during the core part of the pandemic where we were all isolated. But I do know that you know, the virtual everything has instigated a lot of developers to sort of like really much more seriously explore the whole live jamming thing. And I feel like even though the fruit of that labor is going to be displaced, that we are going to, in the coming years, see a lot of those kinds of exciting developments. Album of the week. I've been listening a lot to Church on Hell Street, which is a Punch Brothers record. I'm totally curious where this happens. It seems to be a very popular thing to do in bluegrass circles, where you like cover an entire album, like from start to finish. This is a Tony Rice record that they have decided to play and record track by track. But just like with their signature musicianship and arranging chops, it's tough. Like it's the kind of thing where it's like you hear it, and on like a surface level, like if you sort of like put it on the background while you're cooking, you're like, ah, yeah, okay, this is like very stylistically bluegrass. But then if you really just do some isolated listening and you start to think about what they're doing texturally and tonally and harmonically and even rhythmically with the arrangements, you start to see that they've actually done some very, very interesting and modern stuff with it, but in such a subtle and tasteful way that when you zoom out, it still sounds like bluegrass music. And I think that requires a level of artistry and skill in of itself that's very different than some of the more adventurous kinds of arrangements that they've done before. Not to mention just that, like, you know, through modern production and recording engineering and stuff like that, you can just get these acoustic instruments to sound so incredibly clear and like to portray such a sense of presence when you're listening in good studio headphones. So I'm a big fan.
Very cool. My album of the week, I have an 8-year-old daughter, soon to be 9, but she has fallen in love with the movie Encanto. And so the soundtrack has been playing all the time in my house. And as many movie soundtracks, I'm like, so much. But then this one came on and I'm like, I kept getting drawn to it. I kept singing along with her more often. And I'm like, I kept trying to think about what is it about this soundtrack that I'm enjoying much more than, you know, say Frozen. And I think one of the things about this is the quality of the writing, number one, by Lin-Manuel Miranda and Germán Franco is phenomenal. But I think the performances, and I saw someone do an analysis on this, they had talked about this trend in most music to be better technically all the time and not put as much emphasis on the artistry. And in this movie, every single character is flawed. There's something wrong with them. And it comes across in all their voices. And so in all these performances, they're not technically vocally correct. They're not always done in exactly the prescribed way, but they're done in ways that are incredibly expressive and incredibly artistic. And I think that's why it's so compelling.
What's your favorite song off the soundtrack?
It's got to be Bruno.
I want to unpack that a little bit. So
it's this minor major thing that goes back and forth. I've always been a fan of harmonic minor, especially when it sits on the dominant major. And it does such a great job of going back and telling a story with this in and out of minor and major. And I love that aspect of it.
Do you feel like the songs, because this was my kind of feeling about watching the movie, was like, but then I had to kind of like zoom out and think about like lots of other Disney movies. I don't know if this is like a real accurate assessment here, but do you think that the songs are maybe like a little bit more like plot driven in their lyrical content than the average Disney movie? Like that, it's amazing to me that is the most popular song, it appears, from the soundtrack, when it's like really like, it's like doing so much exposition. It's not like the kind of thing that I imagine being performed in isolation at like a high school talent show or something, you know?
But it does, not only lyrically, but musically. They have this whole song that we don't talk about Bruno, and they're tiptoeing around it, and it's all offbeats. Da, 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 da. And it's like, it sounds like you're on tiptoes around this character. And so there's so many musical aspects that are sort of put into that, you know, the dark and the light, and just, you know, it's really, really well constructed.
Yeah, I don't want to be like a hot take guy, but I think it's like my favorite soundtrack of any Disney movie in the past like 15 years.
I think it's too early to make that analysis, but yeah,
I know. That's why I said I don't want to be a hot take guy. My favorite song is the one that the sister, the very, very strong sister sings.
Yeah, that's the one that my daughter sings constantly.
Yeah, cool. All right, tech tip of the week. So this is one that, rather than me explaining it in all of its glorious detail, I'm going to link out to it because it's a workflow I stole from a podcast called The Automators. And what it basically is, it's like if you have a huge volume of calendar events you're trying to add to your calendar at once, there is a script, and I'll link to it, that you can get from the hosts of the Automators podcast, where basically if you're using Apple's Numbers, which is like their spreadsheet app, you can like you can enter a bunch of events into a numbers spreadsheet, which is just a little bit more of a quick way to get them out and see them laid out. And then you can run a script that will add them. I think I use Fantastical, which is like a third-party calendar app. I think you can do it with the stock Apple calendar app, but it's basically like a one-button touch that takes a list of a bunch of entries in a spreadsheet and just actually puts them in your calendar, which is great because our shared calendar, Google Calendar, is one of our shared collaboration tools, and I can get my sectionals typed out really quick in this numbered spreadsheet and then click a button, and then they go to my, you know, to a particular sectional calendar in my calendar app, which of course also shows up everywhere from my watch to our website. So that's my hack.
So my tech tip of the week is, and I'm sure that Robbie has done a show on the Craft app. If not, he probably will do it at some point soon. But I love this app for its ability to be so transparent with students. The ability to make notes, and it's become my lesson book. And so the tech tip of the week is how to use Craft as a virtual lesson book. So when we were kids, we had the spiral notebook, and you went to your lesson and you got your assignments written down in your lesson, and you took that home when you did your assignments every week, and you brought it back and you got the next week, and it became a running log of what you had worked on. And so what you can do in Craft is do exactly the same thing. Is you can sort of create this online repository of everything you've done from lesson to lesson. You can see the history of the progress and how fast students are progressing, but they have access to that note. You can put in any sort of resources you want to it directly there. They get to interface it through a website. It really does do a lot to make it really easy for students to see the things you're given to them.
In a different way, it kind of fits into that idea of like modular content from before. Like you can still use your learning management system like Canvas as sort of a front end, but then you can, you know, link out to other stuff. And I've been doing a lot of building information inside of Craft. And then because it's so easy to make any Craft document into a little website, like, you know, basically like building stores of information for my students there and then just linking out to it through Canvas. Because like Craft, you know, doesn't have to require like an internet connection or, you know, a web browser to drag and drop anything around. It's just all like, you know, typing into a text editor, basically. So I'm there.
And it saves so many clicks than doing it in Canvas.
Oh, totally, 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 totally.
And you have it for future classes. I mean, so many times you build something for a course, and then it, you know, the course, you have to import it into another course and move it back and forth. And Canvas is not easy to deal with in that regard. If you think about Canvas as being a shell and you have all of your tools on Craft or other apps, then you can put those in place in a much, much quicker sense, and you can do it when you need to.
Totally. All right. So the next episode is going to be based on my other Ohio presentation, communication and collaboration apps for music teams. I guess we'll record that on Monday, and then okay. I'll push that out whenever. Cool. Well, thanks for doing this. Enjoy your all of your many Saturday plans. All right, I'm Robbie Burns. Thanks for listening to Music at Tech Talk. And also, thanks to this episode's sponsor, Light the Music. You can find them at lightthemusic.com. You can find the show's page, show notes for this episode, and my blog at musicedtechtalk.com. You can subscribe to blog posts through an RSS app of your choice, and you can subscribe to the podcast in a podcast app of your choice. You can now get blog posts delivered right into your email inbox once a week. Please rate and review the show in the podcast app you use. It absolutely helps. It'll only take a second and a few taps. Word of mouth is helpful too, so please spread the word about the show. You can learn more about my teaching and music career at robbieburns.com. I'm on Twitter, Facebook, Twitch, and YouTube at Robbie Burns. Please consider supporting me on Patreon at patreon.com/musicedtechtalk. All support tiers get perks, but even the base tier gets you a monthly video update with app and music recommendations and tech tips, and access to the Music Ed Tech Talk Discord community, where you can chat with other supporters and guests of the show about music, apps, pedagogy, lesson ideas, tech support, and more. It's a fun place to be. All right, and we'll see you next time.